We've been waiting a long time to say this. Matthew Knies is a Leaf!
Let's go!
Give me what I want!
Kick down the door!
Drew, you are not doing this!
What the?
Not Knies! There's a giant head!
You hear yourself?
I made like 2,000 of these. I'd like to have fun.
With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
So how'd that happen? Who is this guy and why does that matter now? Before we answer all those questions, think you know which way it's gonna go? Head on over to Sports Interaction. When the puck drops, Sports Interaction has you covered pregame, live betting on all major sports, and prop bets. Want to bet? Head to sportsinteraction.com/SDPN and download the Sports Interaction app using the QR code on the screen, but only, if you're 19 plus, please play responsibly. Now, some of you are gonna be watching this and you're gonna be like, okay, I've heard people talk about Matthew Knies for a while, and they seem pretty excited, and I know it's a big deal, and I don't know why. That's fair. More than fair. Let me back up. So, it's the 2021 NHL Draft. I remember every single player the Leafs drafted in the 2021 NHL Draft, and it's actually quite easy. That's not an accomplishment, because they only drafted three guys! In the sixth round, they drafted a goaltender, Vyacheslav Peksa. In the fifth round, they drafted a little guy named Ty Voigt, and he's gonna be great for another video. Because it was 2021, he's an OHL player, he did not play the entire season before he was drafted, and the Leafs drafted him. 2 years later, he's on the Sarnia Sting, and he was their top scorer. 105 points in 67 games, he led his team in scoring by 23 points. And then there was their second round pick, a late second round pick, 57th overall, Matthew Knies. And this guy is not a little guy. Hockey DB lists him as 6'3", 210 pounds. He's still only 20 years old, and he won't be 21 until a few weeks into next season. The Leafs drafted him from the Tri-City Storm of the USHL, and they must have loved what they saw. And it's kind of funny how different players get treated, because after the USHL, he was gonna go play NCAA. When it's a little player drafted, you're like, all right, yeah, let's see how he does against full-grown men. Like, there's a skepticism to it. With a player the size of Matthew Knies, you're like, all right, let's see how he plays against full-grown men. For the past two seasons at the University of Minnesota, Matthew Knies and most of his teammates have dummied full-grown men. Knies had 15 goals and 33 points in 33 games last season. That was good enough for second on his team in scoring. The guy who led his team in scoring is named Ben Myers. He's much older, and he actually spent most of the season playing with the Colorado Avalanche. This past season, Knies was third on his team in scoring. And that sounds bad. It sounds like he went backwards. I assure you he didn't. 21 goals, 21 assists for 42 points in 40 games. The top scorer on his team is Logan Cooley, the third overall pick of the Arizona Coyotes from last draft in Montreal. He had 22 goals to Knies' 21. Second in University of Minnesota scoring was Jimmy Snuggerud, who is the 23rd overall pick of the St. Louis Blues. He had 21 goals just like Knies. So some of the criticism of the Knies hype train is, what are you talking about? He's the third best player on his line. After watching a little bit of Knies, I don't know if that's true. And also, so what if he is? What if that line is just extremely good and you'd be lucky to have any one of them? From what I've seen in the highlights that I'm sure you've seen, Knies is a big body who can dominate the slot. He finds the spot, and if he likes it, he stays there, and you can't move him. Doggedly determined on the puck, he is gonna follow that thing until the very end. And a lot of his goals, I noticed, were kind of tap-ins. They're right at the front of the net. And sometimes those goals get unfairly devalued, as if they're easy to get. They're not. You get there by being bigger and stronger and more determined than your opponent. But another totally valid criticism, or at very least concern, is, yeah, well, he's playing with an elite playmaker like Logan Cooley. Okay, yeah. Well, he got drafted by the Leafs, though. They have those. You're allowed to have those. And whether you're getting a setup from a guy like Logan Cooley, or, I don't know, Mitch Marner, William Nylander, Austin Matthews, or you're banging and crashing when there's a shot from the point or a shot from the outside, being good at playing in front of the net is always going to be a useful skill to have. Knies himself compared himself to Alex Killorn and Alex Tuck and just everyone named Alex, apparently. And honestly, both of those guys are underrated big bodies in this league. He's exactly the kind of player Leafs Nation has been waiting on And I'm excited. Not to mention, he's a big body from Arizona who can score goals, and the Leafs have done well with those. Here's David Alter with a tweet about Matthew Knies, and this is actually very important because he signed a 3-year contract. Well, what does that mean? Leafs make it official, signing Matthew Knies to a 3-year entry-level contract that begins this season and has an AAV of $925,000. He'll immediately burn off one of the 3 years at the end of this season. So this isn't the sort of thing where you have like a junior player at the beginning of the season and they can play up to 9 games and then you send them back to junior and their contract slides. They don't burn a year on their deal. This is common with university guys, and when you draft a university guy, you sort of just have to make peace with the fact that this sort of thing is gonna happen. It's also worth mentioning that university guys have a choice. He could just choose to not sign with the Leafs the way any university guy can choose not to sign with their team if he just waits his full term at school. Now, obviously, most players don't want to do that on account of if you don't wait your full term at school, you make hundreds of thousands of dollars. But anyway, all that to say, this is a 3-year contract that is really two. Further to David Alter's tweet, Kyle Dubas' statement on signing Knies. In 2 seasons playing for Coach Motzko and his program at the University of Minnesota, Matthew has participated in 2 Big Ten championship games, 2 NCAA Frozen Four championships, 2 World Junior championship tournaments, and 1 Winter Olympic Games. I forgot about that. The impact of that experience, in addition to the massive steps the program at University of Minnesota has helped him take on and off the ice, are something that we are forever grateful for. We look forward to welcoming Matthew to our club this week and helping him continue down the great development path he has been on with the Gophers. They're called the Gophers. And then Cap Friendly wanted to clarify a few things. So Matthew Knies, he signed his 3-year deal. It's $925,000 against the cap. Each year, it's $832,500 plus $92,500. That's signing bonus. And then he'll make $80,000 in the minors if that's where he ends up. Signing bonus is different from performance bonus. If he signs something that's like, oh, I get an extra, million if I score 30 goals. If I'm not mistaken, his cap hit all season would be $0.925 million. But then if he scores 30 goals, which is great because he scored 30 goals, it'll be $1.925. And that could potentially put you into overage when it comes to the salary cap, and that would count against your salary cap the following year. And you don't want that. And it's very important that Kyle Dubas actually got that out of the contract. Now, will Knies remember that when his next contract comes up and ask for more? Almost certainly. But do you want to win now or not? Cap Friendly continues, to be clear, as we had assumed, due to LTIR and cap restraints, the contract does not include performance bonuses. This also means that the Leafs will still have 0 contracts with performance bonuses, and therefore overage penalties are not a concern. And as it pertains to the roster right now, Matthew Knies' contract was registered today. This paves the way for Joseph Woll's $0 cap hit roster emergency recall, league permitting. And the reason that is important, I don't know if you saw this, the Leafs' backup was a university student and not an NCAA one. No, that's cool. We want those. But, and this is unfortunate of the Canadian university hockey system, it's rare for a player to go straight from U of T to the NHL. Jet Alexander did it as an ATO amateur tryout. So the Leafs have 3 games left, one of them's tonight. I assume Joseph Woll, Woll could potentially play all 3. Starting Samsonov against Tampa would be an extremely bad idea. And the last game of the season is against it's against the Rangers. I've made that mistake a bunch of times recently, I'm sorry. So, how does this help the team now? It gives them depth. Matthew Knies gives them depth. Where does he slot into the lineup? He doesn't. That's the long and short of it. I think he plays during the regular season as the Leafs try to get guys rest. And obviously you want to see what you have with this player. Unless he blows the doors off in these final 3 games, I can't see him getting into the Game 1 playoff lineup. Now, if they slip and falter or if there's an injury, absolutely he'll get in there and you need those. How do you ease him into the lineup? How do you this? How do you that? This is not coddling season. This is not sheltered minutes season. This is the playoffs. They're trying to win a Stanley Cup here. Next season, you take all the love and care that you should with a prospect of this caliber. But right now, you play the players who are going to win you the game, and you play them where they're most likely to help you win a game.
Next year, if you want to put him in the top six, even though you don't think he's necessarily ready for the top six, you go right ahead. It's October. It's November. Who cares?
Well, I mean, you should care, but it's less important than now. Is Matthew Knies going to be a better NHLer than Zach Aston-Reese? I think there's an extremely good chance of that. Yeah. Should he be replacing him in the lineup now? No. No, not yet. But it's the playoffs, and ideally it lasts longer than 4 to 7 games. And if that's the case, guys are going to get hurt, and you're going to need other players. You're going to need Matthew Knies, and he'll slot in wherever he's needed. So, what do you think? Should he be in the Game 1 playoff lineup? How would you take a player out? Do you think he should just be a replacement player at this time? And who do you want to see him play with in these final 3 games of the regular season? For now, that's it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends the Gophers in town.